One of them, one of them, one of them. I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them, one of them, I'm one of them. I can say that I can one of them, one of them, I'm one of them. I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them, one of them, one of them. And I can say that I'm one of them. Jesus, thank you, Lord. Thank you for all that you, do for us, Lord. Grateful to you, Lord. No other God than you. Fill us with your Holy Spirit this morning, Lord. Open our eyes and our ears to receive your word. Thank you, Lord. Forgive us, Lord, of our transgressions, our iniquities, our faults, and our failures. And give us strength, Lord, to continue in these days, these last days, Lord. For we know and believe that you are coming soon. Thank you. Amen. Redeemer is faithful and true. Redeemer is faithful and true. Everything he has said, he will do. And every morning, his mercies are new. My Redeemer is faithful and true. My Redeemer is faithful and true. Everything he has said, he will do. And every morning his mercies are new. My Redeemer is faithful and true. My Redeemer is faithful and true. And everything he has said, he will do. And every morning his mercies are new. My Redeemer is faithful and true. Man, thank you, Lord. I could feel a change. He made a walking, talking miracle of me. A walking miracle. Miracle. Since Jesus reached way down his hand and he rescued me. He took the blame and bore my pain. And I will never be the same. Since Jesus made a walking miracle of me. brought Lazarus out of the grave and made the crippled man walk the way. Heal the deaf and dumb, touch the blind man and made him see. And like that miracle he did back then, my Lord can do it all over again. And made a walking, talking miracle of me. A walking miracle, a talking miracle. Rescued me. He took the blame and bore my pain, and I will never be the same. Jesus made a walking miracle of me. And thank you, Jesus. Say the Lord. It's not by might and not by power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord. Oh, this mountain shall be removed. Shall be removed. Oh, this mountain shall be removed. My Spirit, saith the Lord. It's not by might and not by power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord. It's not by might and not by power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord. Oh, this mountain shall be removed. Oh, this mountain shall be removed. Oh, this mountain shall be removed. By my Spirit, saith the Lord. It's not by might and not by power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord.
And not by power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord. Oh, this mountain shall be removed. Oh, this mountain shall be removed. Oh, this mountain shall be removed. By my Spirit, saith the Lord. Amen. There's a little song that you were playing earlier, The Blood That Flows the Highest Mountain, The Lowest Valley. I wanted to try this little song this morning. It's been a long time since we've sung it. It just kind of moved me while she was playing it this morning, and realizing that the reason why we're here this morning, because of the price that he paid. Everything that he ever did, from the creation of man all the way through, and everything that he ever will do to the end or the winding up of things as we know them, were paid for on Calvary's cross. Bought, paid for. He redeemed us out of the pawn shop that we were, by our natural birth, we were born into it. You couldn't help it. We know that. We have an understanding. We're not charismatics and we're not Methodists or Presbyterians. We understand that there ain't one thing good in a human being. All the psychologists and the people that are into counseling, at least most of them that I've read about or read their observations, they're always trying to find the good part in a person, in a human being. Always trying to find a good thing. Even in the killer, there's something good in there, and they try to draw it out. Well, they just don't know what we do. The Bible makes it very plain that in our natural birth, there's one thing that we were worthy of. You hear a lot of people talking about how God's mean and he does this and does that. But because of our natural birth, not just the birth but conception, just because of our natural conception, we were conceived in sin. And I think there is a God being just. How many of you believe that he is? God being just, there's only one final resolution for sin. The wages of sin is death. I didn't make it that way. You didn't make it that way. We were born into it. Happened a long time ago when God entrusted Adam and Eve to hide behind something. It was the Word. They didn't have the blood because there's no blood shed at that time, but he gave them the Word. He gave them the ultimate to hide behind. Because of circumstances and the devil working on the free moral agency, that even they had that. They hadn't partaken of the tree of life yet, but they had been told, don't do it. Then in the conception, Cain and Abel coming forth, and Abel being a replication or a duplicate, a son of God. Satan hated it. He killed him. Started out in the beginning. Satan killed the Son of God. Happened again. But the second time, there was a lot of caveats, I guess. I just learned that word. I think Brother Kelly, that he talking about caveats. But there were a lot of caveats or a lot of purposes in that second death of a Son of God, the Son of God. In it, being God made flesh, he paid the debt that was incurred or brought upon us by the conception of the first sin. Remember, Abel was still conceived in sin. Though he is the Son of God, God was obligated to redeem him. He gave him a revelation, didn't he? What was that revelation? The blood. It struck me this morning while I was just playing that song, and I felt the presence of God kind of move into the building. I appreciate him for it. Not a big bunch of us. Doesn't have to be. I am concerned to try to get across to anybody that I can the things that God has been gracious to allow us to see. Now, we haven't come to perfection yet, but we're working our way toward it. And there's only one way that God can do it, is to reveal himself to us and for us to believe the cure, the double cure for sin. The blood, the Word through the blood. The blood paid the price, but the Word seals it. Oh, and it reaches to the highest mountain. Oh, and it flows to the lowest valley. Oh, the blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power. Oh, amen. Oh, for it reaches to the highest mountain. Oh, and it flows to the lowest valley. Oh, the blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power. Our hearts this morning. How could we ever repay them? Maybe that's why we go through these times in life when things happen, events, situations, for we have no say in it, Lord. We have no strength of ourselves to be able to correct them or to cure it. Makes us look to the provision of the only one that could do it. When you did it, Lord Jesus, you paid the price on Calvary's cross. And then you backed it up, Lord, not just by words, but you backed it up by the resurrection. Love you for it this morning. Asking that your grace would be given to us, Lord, as we look into the looking glass that we desire to see reflected in us. The revelation of Jesus given in the hour that we live in, Lord. Grant it to us, Father. We ask that you'd be glorified in it alone. That everything, Lord, no matter what great thing that you would do upon the earth, we want it to glorify our King, our God, our Redeemer. Do that, Lord, this morning in the things that we have on our heart, burning on our heart, Lord, crying for the bread of life. Asking, Lord, that you would bless it. Again, for your glory, we ask it in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Musicians may go down this morning. Good to be in the little place again. I'm looking forward to the service, yet a little terrified. Musicians may go down if you'd like to. A little terrified this morning. Got a lot on my heart. I've got, I don't know, about 30 pages of notes that I haven't ever got to yet. And I wish I had the ability to be able to just tell you in a few words what I believe, but it covers a lot more area than just what could be accomplished in a service. I was mentioning back in the nursery a while ago, it'd be nice to be able to start on a Saturday morning and go to a Sunday night and just teach. But I also realize that we are still kind of in this veil, that we're trapped. Not a thing you can do about it. Ain't nobody going to go out and shoot themselves. I hope you're not. I think suicide's a coward. That's my opinion. Reading all the stories about, what was that lady that wrote that deal about being in that prison camp? She wrote that a book on it, and she came with quite a testimony in her life. I can't think of her name, but all of the things they went through when people around them was committing suicide and finding the coward's way out, they was looking for another way out. And all the people, I've read stories about how there were soldiers that were in captivity in those death camps and how that they dug underneath the fence from some place in one of the buildings and dug all the way out and got out in freedom. They were pressing for the way out. See, they could have done what some of the cowards did. They could have just ended it and stopped it there. I guess maybe that's right, maybe it's wrong. I think it's right that they just, you know, wanting to die and get out of it on your own, that's a coward's way out. God's looking for overcomers. That's my belief. Yeah, I may be, you know, I may be a little cruel and things like that, but I believe that. I believe that even an animal, I remember in hunting, I don't do a lot of hunting anymore because I can't hardly stand to kill something and gut it. It doesn't do a thing for me, Brother Chuck. I just don't like to do that anymore. And I think about, they used to have a slaughterhouse down here on Central Avenue by Rozier, and me and some of my friends, you know, I had two or three little buddies, and we wanted to go out and see how they killed them cows. And just curiosity. And by the time you go through it, you know, they got that big sledgehammer up there and put those cows through that little narrow place, and then they stop them in there, and that guy used that sledgehammer of the 22. You know, there are two ways of doing it. And once you see something like that die, that death doesn't have the childhood curiosity anymore. But I have noticed that in the Hollywood approach to things, the devil's way, he wants to bring death. He likes to throw death out there in front of everybody. I remember when the old Westerns, you know, and Roy Rogers, he could take a six-shot revolver, Brother Chuck, and shoot all day. Never hit anything, unless he was shooting at a berry or something on a tree. You know, he could do it like this. But then it didn't satisfy everybody. You know, the more modern generation came up, and they wanted to see somebody die. So they started making death more real. To where finally they got the little things that these kids, that they're addicted. Those things are an addiction. Electronic is an addiction because it links to spirituality. I don't want to get into that. You may not accept it, but I know a couple of things. Your brain works off of electrical impulses. And all Satan has to do is to kind of mimic the pictures with electrical impulses. So now they've got, I see it on the advertisements in between. You look at the news, and they'll show a movie, and this guy is, some guy, just blood and guts all over the floor. It's bad. It really gets really gross, because Satan is the author of death. Amen. That's his gospel. Amen. Satan's gospel is the gospel of death. You know, we think sometimes, as I mentioned a while ago, and it is true, that sin's bad. We can't help it. We was conceived in that. And come forth speaking lies, been our whole life. And Satan knows that. He works on the mind. We understand that too. But death ends up being the result of sin. The sin's not the biggest problem altogether. Death is. Because if you can sin and live forever, and the devil's working on that. Through medical science, I was just reading an article, and I liked it. It was an interesting article. Help me, Brother Steve. It's that thing that Sean Hannity is always putting. He took that monoclonal antibodies. And so they found people with a bowel cancer up to the last stage, fourth stage, I guess. It was bowel cancer. It was really bad. And they took that monoclonal antibody treatment, and 100% cure. You've seen that. It's on the news. And now they're thinking, oh, maybe they found a cure for cancer. Now, I'm going to tell you this. I know how Satan works. You think that the medical science is going to use that on everybody? No. Not when they make enough money, or all the money that they make on keeping you coming back so they can kill you another way. Yes. See, the devil, he does it so subtly. You understand when I feel the presence of the Lord move, because I know that's true. Amen. But God provided a way that we can live, but the cost of it is people just don't want to pay that cost. Right. See, and then it comes to what we believe, that only the true seed of God that were in him before the foundation of the world, they're the only ones that can come to the cure. Right. That's right. I'm talking about the real cure. The cure that does this, that they don't come into the condemnation of the judgment. But by taking the cure, they have already passed from death to life. They become free from the law of sin and death. Does that make sense, sis? And that's only one way to do it. You can't do it unless you're ordained to it, unless God predestinated you to it. Then you find yourself crying sometimes for something. And you don't know exactly what it's about. You know there's something somewhere that's calling. That's a drawing. And the Holy Spirit calling. I can remember, as I told you before in the testimonies, when just before the seals were broken, I went to probably a couple of years, well, at least a year. I'll say a year of there was something inside that was crying for something. I didn't know what. I just go out and I feel like I've got to pray. I've got to get closer to God. And, you know, in the Pentecostal move, getting closer to God, you talk in tongues or sing or, you know, something that you do for the church, to spiritual, speak in tongues, prophesy, interpret or something. And I've been through every one of those things, you know, on the Pentecostal level. But it didn't meet that crying that was somewhere down inside, just something crying for the bread of life. See, it wasn't crying for just a spiritual experience. It was crying for the bread of life. I'm going to read that to you again this morning. And just to kind of lay a foundation, we've got, you just have to bear with me. I have to preach by inspiration. I don't know any, I have no other way of doing it. I have to wait till that, you just dropped into the building a while ago, and I feel it moving around a little bit, and I appreciate him for it with all my heart. He knows that. I'm glad he knows your heart. Doesn't mean you're perfect, but it means you know where to go to get your strength. I was watching Nadine, she came in this morning smiling, and she's doing better. I mean, she made it to a whole song service and still sitting back there with her eyes open. No, see, you've been praying for her. God hears your prayer. You can't do it, but God can. But anyway, I want to read this before we get into. I like to talk about the ultimate of redemption. The ultimate, the final act of God in redemption. I'm interested in that. I've believed on him. I'm not really concerned. I guess it's a hard, you have to say it in a way where you understand. Sometimes you use words that's always got little ifs and ands and buts and whatever, you know, about it. But I'm not really worried about being saved. There's nothing that I know that I could hunger for to attain salvation. Now, you know what I'm, some of you know what I'm saying, and some of you don't. So here I have to make a little explanation of it. Salvation is not redemption. This message teaches us that salvation is given to whosoever will. And we don't examine that in a great way. I mean, I'm appreciative of it. I appreciate divine healing, whether God heals a sinner, a crook, a criminal, a good person, I appreciate all that God does. But that's not our goal. To be saved, you have to accept the atonement. Every person sitting in here has accepted the atonement. I believe you have. We're not concerned about being saved. I don't want to have to go through a tribulation period to get there, because I have a little insight into what the tribulation period is going to lead to. The tribulation period is only a step toward the vials. That's all it is. We'll get to those things in our other teachings. And probably here's about the only place you can hear people talking about it. I call it the message. That to have an insight into these things is why Brother Branham came, was to reveal the hidden things of God. Not just to believe that Jesus died on the cross. That's already done. you couldn't change that. But in that provision, the provision for the elect, the redeemed, let the redeemed of the Lord say something. The redeemed of God hunger and thirst after something that the world doesn't thirst after. Or even people that, let's say 99.99% of the religions of the world, including message group, tape groups, churches, whatever they're not hungering and thirsting after the bread of life. What is the bread of life? Wouldn't the bread of life include or be inclusive of the end result of redemption, or the separating factors. I'm not trying to use big words. It just the way it comes out. The separating factors between a person that just makes it through the tribulation period, remembering there'll be a multitude that no man can number. So there's going to be a lot of people that will come under the provision of Jesus dying and saying, whosoever will, let him come. That's good. No problem with that. I believe under that, that we could claim our family. I believe that. If you meet the other condition. That is the condition of the ultimate purpose that God has in redemption. Remember, God restored Job's kids, didn't he? Job being, if I could use this for a kind of a little pattern, everything in the Bible was put there for a reason. God allowing Satan to be turned loose on Job, while that wouldn't even be fair for God to turn the devil loose on you in his full like he did with Job. Most of us can't even take the preacher preaching about being faithful to the house of God. And Job lost it all. And his friends came to him, and they found some fault in him. You know, you're a troublemaker, or you're this, all kinds of stuff. They found something, but God didn't see no fault in Job. I mean, as far as holding it to his account, blessed is the man to whom God will not impute sin. Job was a sinner. He knew he was. But he was trusting in the sacrifices that he had made, that God provided, that Job had faithfully kept. That's all they had back there. It was the blood. They're trusting that that death of that animal took their place. Instead of them having to die for it, that animal died instead. See? But anyway, God knew that Job was the son of God, because when God told Job, he said, hey, I'm just going to put it in my words. He said, Job, I don't see you sitting on that ash heap. I know you're down there. I know you're sitting on that ash heap, but that's not what I'm looking at. I'm not looking at the present day circumstances. I'm not looking at you as being a failure. We all are. We're looking to Jesus. We're looking to the promise of God's word. If we keep that promise, he's obligated to fulfill that promise, not just in himself. He already paid the price for that, but in you. That you can actually, even a woman that wasn't even in the original creation, and don't you get offended at me. If you do, God can forgive you for that. A woman wasn't even in the original creation, but God has provided the way that a woman can actually become a son of God by new birth. Ooh, chew on that one for a while. Instead of getting all, oh, God don't like women, brother. God don't like women, brother. Branham didn't like women. Why get all been fools? You've proven what you are. Then look to him. Look to the provision that Jesus has made through a message that the women hate. So many, those that I love. Don't like the message. They won't listen to certain things. They won't put on certain tapes. Certain tape groups won't put on certain tapes because they're busy doing what that tape preaches against. And I'm like this. If I preach against even my own thinking and it convicts me, then that proves that God's dealing with me. You put on tapes just makes you happy. You're never going to get corrected. It's got to skin the bark off of you. I don't mean to say all that, but that's what I believe the Holy Spirit's saying to us this morning. And there's only one provision that God's made. Let it cut you. If surgery don't cut you, they have a hard time getting to your kidney or whatever they're going to cut on or cut into. We got the Word of God will flay you. It'll lay you wide open. It'll expose you for what you are. It has in me, but it's changed my thinking. It's changed my goals. It's changed things that I'm not even able to share. It's changed things that maybe a few years ago I'd have jumped at the chance. But now I'm looking, I think, Lord, I just want you. Help me. to find you. And you, your desire for the things of the world getting ahead starts leaving. Because you get to thinking, well, maybe it's my old age. See, I'll just attribute it to my old age. You know, up in years, I talked to a little lady yesterday, you know, telling her, I'm 81 years old, and I'm thankful to still be able to get around. And she looked at me, and she said, I'm 91. She says, I can still cook. A little black lady is went over to visit a friend of mine that's probably won't last through the week. A brother that came, brother, well, pray for the family. I don't like preaching funerals, but that's one that she asked me to preach. And I said, we don't do funerals at our church. I want this to be a house of life. If you had a memorial service, that might be okay, but not a funeral, not in a church. You know, if they'd have put a dead body in the tabernacle, they'd have killed every person that went in there. Maybe I'm superstitious, but that's one of my superstitions, that I think the house of God ought to be a place where life is preached. Drag death in here. but anyway, she's only be at the black church, a big black church with a lot of friends and stuff. So you pray for me, and Lord's already given me what to do and how to do that. You know, you come there, you can't help the person that goes. But you can sure help some of them that's still there that needs to make a decision. Amen. And I want to preach on the resurrection. Take way back in the book of Job and just bring it through and see if that'll work for them. And by the way, Brother Will had given his heart to the Lord. Me and his wife talked about that yesterday. He's laying there under hospice. And she said he could hear me, but he's nothing but just a skeleton laying on one of those beds, you know, they give hospice bed, that's a hospital bed. And I that shook me up so bad because I don't like to see a person in that kind of condition. He was so, his death rattle in his throat. And here just a few weeks ago, he's sitting in the service and the Lord blessed him. And he gave his heart to the Lord. I couldn't make elect out of nobody, but he accepted the atonement. And one thing he did accept that I really was pleased with when we talked about serpent seed, man, he said, that's the only way it could be, Rev. So there's confirmation there, all right? But in coming to this morning, I want to talk about the ultimate, and I want to give you a little opinion before we start into our scriptures this morning, and I hope you're sitting here for another 30 minutes. See what I've got? No, I've got 45 minutes, and I hope that something can be said to make you realize that this message is not what's being preached everywhere. That's why I wanted Sister Mary, for that lady that you that Andy got a chance to talk to. I want to talk to her, not try to get members. That's not my motive is not members. My motive is to try to bring somebody up to a little further understanding of why Brother Branham came. And they can claim, oh, don't get upset with me, don't go to sleep on me yet. They can claim all they want to, but what they talk about proves what they believe. Their speech, remember in the book of Acts, the lady, well, actually, it was in the Gospels, the little lady, when Peter was there warming himself by the fire, Jesus was in the halls of Pilate, and he started talking to her, and she talking to him, and she said, your speech betrays you. What you talk about makes a difference, doesn't it? I'm going to read this to you. Again, because it kind of is a summary of what we're looking for. So now remember that Moses was born for a certain work, a specific. All of the things that happened in Moses' life had a end result. Right? But he could not do that work until he had received the gifts which would enable him to do the work. He had to go out in the desert and wait there. God had an appointed time. There was to be a certain Pharaoh on the throne, and the people had, I got it circled in red in my Church Ages book, and the people had to be crying for the bread of life before God could send him back. This is true for our day. Crying for the bread of life. Crying for the bread of life. You know, that could probably be looked at through a lot of different views or lenses of looking at that. Crying for the bread of life. But I'm of my opinion, I'm trying to place this in a way that would be maybe understandable to you. Crying for the bread of life would be the end result. Moses went through all the stuff he went through. He had the showdowns with Pharaoh. He had, when early in his life, he ran from Egypt, ran out in the desert, and all the things that he came in contact with. But that wasn't the purpose that God sent him for. It was only the path, or from the seed purpose until it unfolded to, he took them through to the promised land. Now, he didn't get to enter into it, but his purpose was to take them to the promised land. He did that. He didn't take them in, he took them to. That was the end result. And I believe that there's something in this crying for the bread of life, if we understand what that bread of life is, it would have to parallel the purpose of Jesus, because he is the bread of life. Church is not the bread of life. No, Jesus, the Word, is the bread of life. And the end result of that bread of life isn't just to feed you good things. And that it's included in it. That's why we're here this morning, is because we are here to feed the sheep. We're here to feed the elect of God. You have to feed them on the same bread. Jesus said he is the bread of life. He was that when he was here in a body that could die. And that bread of life is being waved. I want to kind of see if I can instill this in the minds of the church, of something being waved over the people that is not the end result of it. It's only being waved over the people in word form. Can I use the word, the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy being waved over the people. The testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Whether it's Old Testament, New Testament, it still points to the end result. I've been kind of not skirting the issue, but trying to make suggestive announcements along the way that's what we're looking for. We are not looking back to Brother Branham's first pull. I wanted to sink in. That was part of the bread of life for that time. But we can't go back to that and rest in that alone. We accepted that. Jesus died on the cross, shed his blood. We've accepted that. You understand what I'm saying? But that wasn't the full purpose. That only built the foundation for the path or the road that God had provided to get to this end result. That's the part of the bread of life I'm crying for. I'm having the same thing happening in my heart that had happened at the breaking of the seals. And I believe I know what it is. I can't say positively, but I think I do. God don't come down and tell you, hey, this is this, but by the things that have happened pertaining to what I feel to be the calling in my life for the message has been, when Brother Branham came to me in, I don't remember what year it was. I couldn't even tell you what year. It was about 70, 75, 76, somewhere in there. And I went in the old church on Sunday over there to lay down just for a few minutes and pray and meditate. And all of a sudden, Brother Rand came to me. I told you that before. It happened. And he told me, he said that he's going to get me out of whatever place I was in because I was trapped. I was in a place that was kind of trapped, and he got me out of there, and he's standing there, and he took his left hand. He said, remember, it has to be under that ministry. He said, I am going to take you to a place up. He took his left hand facing the east, and he moved it this way. So I'm going to take you to a place up this way, and it's 3 miles long. I didn't know what it meant. In fact, I don't, I, I, everything I I knew it had something, or believed it has something to do with what God's going to lead me to. And sometimes when you look back on where God's led you, it kind of gives you the idea. If God promised through that prophet that he is going to do a certain thing, we know that in the West, Phoenix, that it ought to make a church, then that becomes kind of the position of the bread of life or the promises. Are you understanding what I'm saying? Crying for the bread of life. Not to prove that Brother Branham was a prophet. I already believe that. I don't have to keep trying to convince myself. I know sometimes if you tell something, sometimes you can say it enough times you get to believe in it. Maybe repetition is not bad in every sense. Sometimes repeating these things might be a good thing, see. But we already believe that. I believe Brother Branham came. We got three people sitting in here. Was there? If I told you it wasn't so, they could tell you, hey, Brother McGraw, you're lying. They were there. I was there. So I already believed that. And I believe that it was a ministry that made all of the other great, so-called, greats of that time. This is from my perspective. I'm talking about the bread of life. I'm not talking about just you know, eating a little morsel of dried up crust. I'm talking about the bread of life. The bread that is fed to produce life. What those other brothers had, it never produced life. It never gave anybody a change in their body. It never brought a latter rain. It never brought the harvest. Never brought anything. But the message that Brother Branham brought has a promise to bring forth life. That's what we're looking for. So, all right, let's start with our scriptures and get into our little something. I want to read these scriptures. Paul says, unto me, who am less than the least of all saints. Now, that would kind of knock out a lot of message preachers. Man, it was a prophet of God is how he thought of himself. Until you can think of yourself in the way that Paul did, God's never going to trust you with a whole lot. If you think you're something, that it was you that did it, you're on the wrong road. It's either going to be Jesus or nothing. Amen. It's God that did it. Amen. If we're here this morning, how many has ever done that? Kind of you do a replay of things that's happened in your life, stupid things that you've done, stupid, absolutely stupid things that all God would have had to do just to brush you aside, he'd have been justified in doing it. When that really strikes you, you become nothing. Then God can do something. Then after that, if God really makes you realize you're nothing but a hunk of dirt, then you could never come when you... I'm talking about a realization, not just saying it. When you come to that realization, then anything that God does for you proves he's God. Prove that you didn't have one say in it. Not one thing. Been his grace. And that's what Paul's saying here to me. Hope these things are okay. You got, Brother Branham said, the way up is down. Not putting him down, putting you down. And lifting him up. Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men to me. And I wrote this down before I go any further than this. I can't think of a better way to magnify the Lord. Is that what David said in the book of Psalms much? No, it's constant songs. Magnify the Lord. That's what they did. That's what you come in here doing. You raise your hands. You praise the Lord. I hear sometimes a voice saying, oh, praise God, or something like that. You're magnifying him. Amen. But you've got to become nothing to magnify him. Amen. So I can't think of a better way to magnify the Lord concerning the resurrection, which is the capstone of the bread of life. It's a capstone. The resurrection. Amen. Then to understand and proclaim the end result and the purpose of that resurrection and the preparation for it. That's what we're doing. That's what I hope we're doing. Because nobody's going in the rapture. Actually, the body change is part of the resurrection purpose. Amen. Do we have a couple of words that we used before I read any more on this? Do we have a couple of words that fit that same time frame, kind of like adoption?
Yes.
The adoption, to wit, that is the redemption or the change of this body, the redemption of this mortal body.
Amen.
And Jesus, or Paul said, pointing to it, he said, by this means will he, Jesus, finish the whole job, the capstone of it, by giving us a body change. That's what we're after.
Amen.
Now, we've already come through the first pull and the second pull, but going back to our scripture before we read some more this morning, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given that I should preach amongst the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by... Exactly. Paul didn't say the word, he said Jesus Christ, but the revelation of it, Jesus Christ, is the anointed word for the day we live in. Now, Paul started it. I want to emphasize on a couple of points that we have been hitting on through our Thursday services and on, that a very important thing I believe saying here, that it's a developing process, and it is the terminology that we read, I believe, Thursday night, the faith of the fathers.
Amen.
The faith of the fathers, the culmination, the end result had to be something that brought them to something they weren't because they never achieved it. To the intent that now unto the principalities and the powers in heavenly places might be known by the church. I want to just pause on that just a minute. Something strikes me. How many people that proclaim this message? Now, some of you haven't run across, some of you have. I believe Sister Claudia has. Maybe some of you that visit with people that claim the message. They seem to think, or at least there seems to be the suggestion, I'll put it that way, that since Brother Branham broke those seals, that's all that was needed, because those seals are broke, he knew what they are, and we're under him knowing that. Well, that is Baptist theology, but it's on a higher level. Baptists think just because Jesus died on the cross and took our sins on him, that they can sin all they want to because they claim they're under his redemption. See, they twist the word of God to their own devices. And I think that happens in this message. They say, oh, we don't have to know those things. We just believe it because Brother Branham said it. You understand what I'm trying to say? They're wrong.
Yes.
Paul's saying here that it might be known. I'm emphasizing. I hope you're reading along with me. See what I'm trying to emphasize here. That these heavenly things might be known by the church.
Right.
And that word known has to do with an intimate relationship with Jesus Christ. Which means that every one of you have to have the baptism of the Holy Ghost, which produces the new birth. And the new birth is the revelation of those mysteries.
Amen.
Let me do it again. To the intent or the end result. Would that be the intent?
Yes.
You know, you might start out doing a lot of things, but you got something that some of us do. I know sometimes I run around looking for a tool that's in my hand. I forget my intent. Well, I look at all the smiles in these faces. You know, you do that. You wonder, what I come to the kitchen for? And you've only got 5,000 things on your brain, what little brain you got, and it just happens to file away real quick when you enter that room, you know. But Paul's saying there to the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church.
Amen.
I'm little kind of yelling at you a little bit this morning. Individually, and in order to know that, remember, it's not given to anybody except the elect of God. If they don't want to know it, they're not crying. Brother Branham said they have to, the true church has to be crying for the bread of life. That's what brings our Moses out of the wilderness.
Amen.
Getting my point? Now, see, I read things maybe, I hope you do. Hope you read those things realizing there's an intent. There's all of the things that happen. They're all important because they're all ordained to God. First Paul was ordained to God. He had a purpose in that. One of the great purposes in that was to fulfill Scripture that Jesus prophesied was going to happen. There would come a proliferation or an increase in false prophets all over the land. Pertaining to them saying, Jesus is the Christ, and through that deceive many. You get it? So everybody that says, Jesus, Jesus, will not enter into the kingdom of God. The Bible says. It's putting scriptures here a little, there a little, and so forth, but it puts them together in a sequence to find an intent that God had in mind. Will you? Got some good things later on. Brother Kelly took the pictures of, well, Brother Manny helped me out in putting all the scriptures we put together over a year, or more than that, years, putting all the scriptures, one leading to the other, and we'll take a couple of services on that a little later on, and you can write them down. Yeah, he was going to make copies, but I don't want to make anybody that, but maybe we could have copies printed up of it once you get to understand it. And you can go, I've got, what I did, he gave me the revised copy, and I took it home and went through it, and he put 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, which puts it in my baby plane of understanding. And Brother Manny, he did like Brother Ram does, he drew a little line with an arrow on it and pointing here, and he knew where he was going. And he sat down with me outside a couple of Saturdays ago and went through that. I felt the presence of the Lord come so strong, I thought the top of my head was going to come off. He may not realize that, but that was God that let him do that. Amen. Put that together. Because one man, look, I'm not a one-man leader. We need each other's help. I need your prayers. When you go through these things to where you feel so helpless, praying for that man yesterday, praying, felt like the prayer just went out of my mouth and fell on the floor. And him laying there with his mouth wide open, that death gurgle in his throat. And I'm thinking, this ain't the man that I knew. See? When it's out of your hand, I need your prayers.
Amen.
I'm not the guy that's got the secret words. God does.
Amen.
And you have to be in time and season. There's not, Brother Branham asked us to pray for him. Now I guess I more realize that he really needed that than when was it the service over there? He told about the services at the time. And he said, I'm going to go up to the northwest as far as I can go. Cry to God. He said, pray for me. And I'm going, we came here to get prayed for. See, we just didn't know. So that's why the Bible says pray one for another. Because maybe you'd fill in a gap that somebody else couldn't fill in. Maybe somebody's going through something that normally they'd have the confidence and faith to do it. They're going through a testing time where their faith has all run out to their little toe. Anybody ever feel like that? Yeah. You're walking on top of the mountain one day and you're praying. Boy, it seems like the Lord's answering every prayer you pray. I've had it happen for a week at a time. And then all of a sudden, all of that faith goes down like that. I don't know where it runs out, but it's got to run out somewhere. And something comes up, you think, where'd that faith go?
Yeah.
Letting you realize that it ain't you.
Right.
Remember Brother Brand was standing on those prayer lines time and again, throwing up into his mouth and swallowing that vomit. How do you know, Brother? He said so.
Yeah.
And yet miracles, cancers falling off on the floor. Miracles happen. Blind eyes being opened, deaf ears being unstopped. Paraplegics walking and him throwing up in his throat. And then walk away when that anointing lift and hide. Remember what he said about Elijah? They had that power out there to challenge Jezebel to her face and kill 400 prophets of the groves and 400 prophets of the whatever else. And then turn around and run when Jezebel said, I'm going to kill you. He took off running. See, it's not the man.
Amen.
It's God. He's showing himself to be sovereign. That's what he is. All right. You say, oh, you're putting down Brother Branham. No, I'm just telling you Brother Branham had a human side too, just like you do. So you search the things that he said to find where God told him, thus saith the Lord. And you hold fast to it. All right. So it was whose wisdom to reveal it to the church? It was the wisdom of God. It was in his plan all the time. There's no excuses for you sitting down with people as I hope I'm not doing this to be wrong, because I can't say that it didn't bother me, hurt my feelings. I was trying to get a phone call for somebody to call. I wanted to share something with them, a vision that Brother Branham had, and they didn't want me to know their phone number. Hurt my feelings. Now my purpose, I had to check my attitude, my thinking. Why am I doing this? It's motive. I had to check it. Why am I wanting this to happen? Even in dreams, it would go in dreams that I was trying to help to instruct. I thought, maybe that's God talking to me. Maybe I'm supposed to try to help the situation. And then they didn't want me to have the phone number. I thought, well, did it hurt my feelings? Oh, yeah. But it don't make me hate nobody. There was a time that I think, well, you know, bunch of unbelievers. Yeah, you do. But I can't do that because I don't know the end result. If God leads you to do something, you follow it. If it doesn't work, you walk away from it best you can. Because he's got something for you later on anyway. So I couldn't think of a better way to preach about what he's saying here, the manifold wisdom of God. Is that the end, Brother Nathan? Is that the last one on that particular one more? According, however many I gave you, according to the eternal purpose which he purposed in the Word. Amen. Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. All right. Now I'm going to, I guess that was all, it was 11, was that the last one that I had on that? It should be there on the screen. I didn't want to go there yet. That goes into another area. I put enough scriptures over there just to kind of get a point across and then want to elaborate on that particular area if I can. I'm trying to learn. I hope you're learning along with it. But anyway, let's just leave that one up there because that's where I'm going with these three stages. And I think I've still got 15, 16, 20 minutes. If you give it to me. I put here, I believe that we need to understand that the resurrection is not just a one-part happening, but it includes many scriptural prophetic events that culminate in the rapture itself. Does that make sense to you? The resurrection is not just a one-time thing like the church world is teaching it. That everybody's going to be floating along, being a good Baptist, Methodist, Pentecostal, whatever they are, and all of a sudden, the trumpet's going to blow, and the dead's going to raise up, and they're going to grab your hand and jerk you up into the heavens. That's basically what's being taught. I might elaborate on it a little differently, but that's what we were taught, that about the time the dead, the graves are going to break open, you know. And trying to be reasonable, I got to thinking, what about people that drowned? What about those people that were sawn asunder or died in the desert? Or something ain't making sense here. Because that's what they were teaching, that about the time the people that came out of their graves got up to this level, that we would join with them together and all be caught up to meet the Lord near. I'm going, something ain't making a lot of sense. Got to think about the old, this is years ago. Now, something's got to make some sense here, because what's being taught to me ain't what the Bible says. The resurrection covers a great big area of time. And God, by his infinite mercy, has laid out before us a pattern. I want to emphasize that on that little script that we've got in on those pages. That's the emphasis. There is a series of scriptural prophetic things that point to that that have to take place before that body change can come. The resurrection's part of that, but the body change is still part of that too. Because the people that raised from the dead already get their body change. Or at least however many come up. Doesn't say, does it? We'll get to that later. I want to read a couple of things. I was going to read this. Oh. Give me a minute. At least I got a place to stack my stuff now. I might have to wait on this. I'll do that. All right. Let's go to what Brother Ram talking about. Now, we know that the resurrection. I'm going to do something different. We'll get to this other part tonight. I'm going to read several pages to you because I've got about enough time to do it. When Brother Branham talking about this pattern, there has to be a pattern. There has to be Old Testament patterns for everything that's going to happen again. Doesn't mean that the church world understands what those patterns mean. But this message came to reveal to us the patterns of the Old Testament. You could even use something as far out as Enoch walked with God and it was not. So the latter rain people got a hold of that and put it together with that scripture that those that believe the word shall never die. They put the two of them together and they said Enoch must have believed all the word and he lived forever because God took him. And then they used Elijah and a few others too. But that's not what it's meaning. All it's saying is simply that there is a hidden meaning in Enoch. And I think that even myself, thinking all the time that that was a type of the whole bride of Christ. And I believe that it does. I believe that, how many knows there's a compound application? I get to rattling around here because Enoch walking with God has to be the whole bride. And then that brings up other questions about what about those that without us can't be made perfect. There's a lot of things that's got to be considered in getting them perfect to be like Enoch, to walk with God. Because of these other ages, see, I get into that, and I probably get people upset with me, but I get into that thinking, if they without us, that's part of the mystery of the message. They without us cannot be made perfect. So evidently, they don't have what it takes in order to be perfect. And that word perfect doesn't always mean finished result. It means for a time. Now see, that brings up another thing. The faith of the fathers. They never attained to that. They were perfect in their time, but not complete. How many understands there's a distinction with a difference that should be important to every one of us when we begin to evaluate the application of the meaning of Scripture. Amen. They without us can't be made perfect. Man, if I could be like Paul. How many times in Pentecost, Sister Claudia and Becky, maybe some of the others that most of you didn't go through Pentecost like we did, but we thought, if I could be like Paul. No, I mean that. I wouldn't even mind being like Paul right now. My problem is I'm stuck in a Garrow McGraw body. So I'm not like Paul. God didn't make me to be like Paul. But God made Paul to be like Paul so Paul could reach perfection here in the resurrection. That's what Jesus said. Be ye also, well, individually, which kind of goes along with that scripture that we were mentioning a while ago, the church must believe the mysteries. Or you couldn't be perfect like Jesus was perfect, because everything that we're teaching this morning was in Jesus when he was here. Every one of you, if you're elect of God, any one of us in this building this morning, and I'm only responsible for that, and those that are on the hookup that are believing, every one of you, if you're elect, you are in Jesus. You were in him. Because the fullness of the Godhead bodily was in his body, and every predestinated thought of God, both past, present, and future, was in that body. It wasn't manifested, but it was there. How many understands it? That's a deep subject, because this whole Bible was in Jesus. In the beginning, Jesus created the heavens and the earth. So it had to be in him. That's Godhead. See, that's Godhead on a level that the world don't even talk about. It messes their mind up. Like stirring hot pudding, nothing but bubbles. Oh, I love him. Look, I hope in the process of our coming here and sitting together and fellowshipping around this message that we do, hope we come to the understanding, reality understanding, that the whole Bible is Godhead. It was in God's thinking before the world began. There was only him, God, not heads, Godhead. Even understanding the evil was in God to begin with. Before the foundation of the world, and his plan, knowing that that was going to happen, he put that into a certain perspective to fulfill or to honor him, to bring forth honor to God. I accept that. I accept it. I believe it with all my heart. He can do whatever he wants to do. He didn't make the evil. He created circumstances knowing that his arch enemy that he created to be as close to him as any creation he could create was called Lucifer. He said, thou was perfect in the day that I made you. But the potential laid in Lucifer, the seed laid in Lucifer to create evil by choice. And so God allowed the circumstance. See, oh boy, I'm going to get sidetracked. I get excited because things start kind of rolling in front of me. When God created Lucifer, he knew Lucifer was going to be his greatest competitor. He couldn't play with babies. God could not play checkers with a baby in the crib. It wouldn't work. Wouldn't he be becoming to his greatness? So he created something that would be the highest order of creation, and that was the Son of the Morning. And look, maybe that's why that the birthday of Lucifer manifested on the earth comes when the sun comes to his darkest and then comes light again. Son of the Morning. Don't think of it. That's what he originally, Lucifer was Son of the Morning. Not Son of God. No. God couldn't do that, or he had to keep him that. Every word of God means something. Oh, I'm feeling good. Oh, we're sitting together in heavenly places. Son of the Morning. And we know that Lucifer wants to be shown himself Christmas Day. Dark day, and then Son of the Morning. Easter celebration, Son of the Morning. Worshiping of the sun. And they go, oh, it's nothing wrong with that, Brother McGraw. It's because the lack of revelation. Amen. When you see and realize what it points to, you worship Jesus Christ by the word. Amen. Not getting up and worshiping a tree.
Right.
Or the sun.
Right.
Or the stars.
Right.
Or astrology.
Right.
Somebody said, oh, Brother McGraw, part of the argument that I had with these disbelieving people said, Brother Branham was an astrologist. He's of the devil, blah, 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 like that. I said, Brother Rand didn't teach astrology. I said, he taught what the Bible teaches, what Job said. That even Pleiades and Orion have an influence on, well, by the way, and when I said this, they started saying that I tried to say that they believed that Satan created. I said, after all, God created the heavens and the earth before Lucifer ever got a hold of everything. So he wrote the Bible and the stars. That's been proven. Why is the whole world looking at the sign of this eclipse or the eclipses, they know there's something in anybody that's born, life put in them, there's something in them that cries for something. But they don't know what it is. And they got people that's driving thousands of miles to go to Arkansas, poor idiots. Excuse me for you people who live in Arkansas. Or Missouri or wherever it might be. But they wanted to go over, spend thousands of dollars during their vacation. Now they found out that their first plot of the center of the eclipse is going to be about 15 or 20 miles off of what they first. And those people trying to find the center of it so they can get in darkness. Seemed like they'd rather walk in darkness than in light. I'd rather just stay over here and know about it and worship God. Arizona's going to get, what, about 60%? And besides, it's supposed to be cloudy Monday. That's tomorrow Monday, right?
Yeah.
Supposed to be cloudy, so that's going to, oh, that's going to upset their worship. Well, the Bible said they'd worship not the Creator, but they worship the sign. We know what the sign points to, and the sign ain't the object itself. Points to the resurrection sign. Nineveh, seven times. And they don't get it. Sure, it was judgment. I have no problem with all these people. I went through it, been going through it in the evening, and take a little nice little tablet that I've got and just type it in, see what it is, and all the different opinions and stuff like that. Oh, it's a sign of judgment. It's a sign of judgment. It's a sign of judgment. Why, even the heathens knew that. See, there's that whatever it is inside of a person that knows that means something. Did the heathen do it? All the way back through the ages. They take it all the way back to as far as they can go. How did they, that even the heathen scared them to death when those signs, they knew that that blackout had something to do with vengeance or judgment or something bad going to happen. They connected it with their gods. Well, we connect it with ours too that made the universes. Not just a little sign. Now, those signs have happened the way, look, I'm going to sidetrack, but it's all right. I hope a little information helps. When I was researching, trying to find the time that Jesus was born, it was still a big question, and they still don't know. I've read some of the best scientists they've got, and almost every one of them has got a seven-year tribulation period. They take it off, especially at Seventh-day Adventists, the Smith people. They're very, very good at what they do in their area. In fact, a guy said one last night, and I had to change it to another deal. He said, the mark of the beast is keeping Sunday for your Sabbath. Because they think that they're the sign to the Seventh-day Adventist of the baptism of the Holy Ghost is keeping the seventh day. And I'm going, they have said that so long, they actually get to believe in it. You say, it's a lie. Of course it is. How many places on the earth do you have the same day at the same time? I used to ask my uncle by marriage's brother. I was a family, the Cooley family. I used to ask him, he was Seventh Adventist. I said, how are you keeping the Sabbath? He said, I keep Saturday. I said, it's not Saturday in Israel. The beginning of the day started the day before. He didn't want to talk about it. You know why? Because they're wrong. If it doesn't make sense, don't do it. At least when the scripture, this message, even though it don't make sense to the unbeliever, it makes perfect sense to the believer because it runs everything to a perfect continuity. It unfolds to us the anointed word, Jesus Christ. I'm sorry, I'll have to pick this up tonight. Can we begin with 1, 2, 3, 4 pages out of a tape? Nobody can say I'm not part of the tape group. I just want you to hear what the tapes are saying. That's what I want. I want you to hear what those tapes are saying. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying by way of the messenger. Would that be our show on that night? It's 11:30. How many's enjoyed this morning? I've felt the presence of God so strong. See, we're getting close to something. I realize that. I've noticed a change in my own when I depend on Him. And not that don't go through dark days, but when He comes, there's something like it's, I don't know how to explain it. Maybe you don't sense it, but I do. I believe we're right on the verge of the resurrection. That's what we're looking for. Brother Ram said the next thing for the church, the bride, the next thing for them is the resurrection from the dead. The out, And that's why we're talking about this, because I want you to be ready for it. I want you to believe unto. Whatever God requires, and you can't be part of that without following the rules, the law. The laws of God. Nature is the laws of God. We're still under them, by the way. If you jump out of an airplane without a parachute, you got a pretty good chance of breaking your neck. And the laws of God have laid out, there are three stages that you've got. One stage you've got to go through to get, you've got to catch the one stage that is the door to the next stage. Then whatever happens under that next stage is the door to the third stage. Shout. Voice and a trumpet. I have a revelation from God. Believe it is, because I can take it through. That's what we want to do. Take it to what the prophet said. Take it to what the Bible says. And then see if you believe it. Amen. We do. Let's stand this morning. Still morning. Oh, a little song that I love. I've been sitting around the table of the Lord, feasting on the good things He provides. And now forever, with Him, my hungry heart abides, sitting around the table of the Lord. It's a song. I don't want to try to teach you to a church because I have a hard time singing it myself. But it's a cute little song. Sitting, I believe the Statesman used to sing that. I used to buy, it was one of my favorite groups when I was young. And I bought every record that I could find for the Statesman. And I've still got it on tape. And you get to listen to it and I think, maybe one or two is okay, but some of them sound like rock and roll to me now. I like worship. I love to worship. You know the best way to worship Him? What does the Bible say? Come on, real quick before we go. God is a spirit, and they that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and truth. Then you sing. You sing about what you believe when the light strikes it. Bow our hearts. Oh, God. Most High, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Lord, You're so great, so big. Walking through the parking lot almost every evening, Lord, closing the gates and looking up at those stars and thinking, we look at all that great heavens and the multiplied billions and billions of miles and stars and even the science declaring that a star is getting ready to appear that we've never seen before. Burst of light, yet we're seeing something that's not even there. How that the greatness and the bigness of God, we can't wrap our mind around it. But You've given us Your word, Lord, and You put it on a level of a kind of a hillbilly prophet that spoke like You did when You were here, where the common people heard Him gladly. We're so thankful for that this morning, Lord, that You can reveal to us Jesus Christ through little simple words and terms, but by spiritual revelation. Grant it to us this morning. We ask it that You'd bless these things in the hearts of Your people in the name that's above every name, the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. You're dismissed.